in the house of the Lord today. God is good, amen? Man, I'm excited about today. If you miss tonight, I'm telling you, you're going to miss a good time. One of the things that's happened this summer when we've done our family activities is that we've just been amazed at how much fun we have together. And it has helped us just in all areas of our life and build relationships. So we're just going to have a great time. How many of you have ever played Gaga Ball? Okay, some of you played Gaga Ball. Pastor Dieta and I learned how to play this week. It's just a lot of fun. Your kids will have a great time. We might even let you in there. And we've got some fun activities planned. But more importantly than that, there's some of you who are new in our midst that we'd love to get to know you and spend some time with you. And the food is going to be fabulous as always. Brother Ernie Roberts has refurbished the grill so that it will work at maximum efficiency. It's going to be great, and we want you here with us. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Today I start a two-part series entitled Summer Vacation, What These Bible Heroes Did Last Summer. The title of my message today is How to Prevent Sunburn. So if you'd go with me to Daniel chapter 3, to the story of the three Hebrew children. How to prevent sunburn. You'll get it in a moment. The Bible says, in verse 8, it says, at that moment some Chaldeans came forward, seizing a chance to attack the Jews. They said to King Nebuchadnezzar, "Long live the king. Your Majesty, you gave a command that everyone who hears the sound of the horn, the pipe, the zither, the lyre, the harp, the flute, and every kind of instrument should bow down and worship the gold statue. Anyone who wouldn't bow and worship would be thrown into a furnace of flaming fire. Now there are some Jews, ones you appointed to administer the province of Babylon, specifically Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who've ignored your commands. They don't serve your gods, and they don't worship the gold statue you set up. In a violent rage, Nebuchadnezzar ordered them to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and they brought him before the king, and Nebuchadnezzar said to them, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, is it true that you don't serve my gods or worship the golden statue I've set up? If you are now ready to do so, bow down and worship the gold statue that I've made when you hear the sound of all those funny-sounding instruments. But if you won't worship it, you will be thrown straight into the furnace of flaming fire. Then what God will rescue you from my power? They answered King Nebuchadnezzar, we don't need to answer your question. If our God, the one we serve, is able to rescue us from the furnace of flaming fire and from your power, your majesty, then let him rescue us. But if he doesn't, know this for certain, your majesty, we will never serve your gods or worship the golden statue that you've set up. Amen.
Amen.
So what I want you to understand today as we begin this series, and my tongue-in-cheek title is How to Prevent Sunburn. Much the way that you would prevent sunburn, we start by understanding that all you got to do is the right thing. All you got to do is what you know you're supposed to do.
Amen.
You put on sunblock. And if your belly like mine is as white as my shirt, then you use, you keep your t-shirt on. So funny. It's true, though. You just do what you know to do, and you don't stay out in the sun too long, and you drink water, and you do all of the things. It's not really that hard to not get a sunburn, right?
Amen.
But my goodness, seems a little difficult. See, because my confession before you is that Saturday before last, I had a killer sunburn. Because I just had one of those moments. Now, all of you think I'm vain. You just pray for me. Just had one of those moments where I was so tired of scaring the children anytime I took my shirt off that I thought, I ought to get, you know, just a little bit of Italian. I live in Florida, for Pete's sake. You know, I ought to get a little bit of one. No, I'll keep your shirt on deck. But it just happened that quick because I thought, you know, 30, 40 minutes. So you understand what I'm saying? So the thrust of my message today, and as we look at the principles that we're going to learn from the three Hebrew children, is that how many of you just had an Old Spice commercial flashback? Now, I don't want to offend you if you wear that, but how many of you can smell that and you're just like, oh, do you have that smelling memory now? Yeah. Lord help us. We're going to have fun today, aren't we? The three friends in today's scripture exhibited great courage as they faced being thrown in the fiery furnace. We all face bad and difficult situations over which we have little or no control. Amen? So what do we do? How can we face those situations with faith? That's what this message is about. As we look at Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and what they faced, we'll see that the king erected this statue as large as his ego and demanded everybody bow down. Because he'd been warned in a dream by Daniel that his kingdom was on shaky ground. So he was trying to tighten his grip on all of those who were in his empire. And given how divisive religion can be, what better way than to consolidate his power than to have everyone worshiping the same thing? Him. Most pagan people back in those days were polytheistic, and so what's the big deal? Just add one more. Unless you were one of these faithful Hebrews who had been exiled in Babylon after their homeland had been conquered. Well, you know that there's only one God, and he told us he's a jealous God. Amen? Amen. And in no uncertain terms, we understand that bowing down and worshiping any other god is a major sin. It breaks the first two of the Ten Commandments. Their example inspires me and terrifies me a little bit. If we could be transparent and think about what that moment might look like someday in our own life, under those circumstances, what would we do with a large assembly of people all looking at us? Everyone is bowing down. Who would judge them if they just went along with the crowd? And who would even know? Besides, think about how they could rationalize this away and say, I could go ahead and bow down and actually not worship that, but in my heart, in my mind, I'm worshiping the true God. So as you hear me say that, you hear some of the rationalization for some of the things that we do and some of the places that we go, and that we say, well, I'm not really drinking in that bar. I'm witnessing to people. Anyway, I could be worshiping God while other people thought I was worshiping the idol. Besides, I could do more good for God's kingdom by staying alive than being a crispy critter. Besides, I have a wife and the kids to think about. Who's going to take care of them if I get myself roasted? And it's just one little sin. God will forgive me. I'm thankful that the example of Scripture here was to their credit. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego had the integrity not to bow, even after their lives were on the line, even after Nebuchadnezzar gave them a second chance to bow down. Their decision was to do that which was right. And here's what I want you to see. Here's the point of where we are in this story as it relates to our contemporary culture. Where they were is that this decision, making the right decision, put them in direct opposition to the majority of the culture and popular opinion. To do the right thing is not going to win you a popularity contest. But what I'm confident of today is that doing the right thing, whether anybody else does or not, will please the Lord. It's how we were raised. That's what my father used to say. When someone would do us wrong or everybody else was doing it, my father's consistent line was, son, we're going to do the right thing whether anybody else does or not. And our country today needs a church that will stand and say, I'm going to do the right thing whether anyone else does or not. Amen? And hear me clearly today that my shirt, what I just said, it's not a political statement. It's a Bible statement. It doesn't matter what party you are in or what party you're about to start on your own because you don't like any of the others. Come on, somebody. But it's about kingdom principles. Because here's what I know about that day. Here's what I know about that large assembly of people. Is that those three boys were not the only ones in that crowd who had been raised right and who were of Jewish descent and who'd been carried into exile. There was a whole mess of folks in that large assembly who should have stood with them. So my challenge to you today is to stand and do the right thing, whether anybody else does or not. Amen? The second thing I want to share with you this morning is that my resolve is to serve him even if. I said my resolve is to serve him even if. Let me read it to you in the message. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered King Nebuchadnezzar, "Your threat means nothing to us. If you throw us in the fire, the God we serve can rescue us from your roaring furnace and anything else you might cook up." See, I love the message. Cook up, get it? O king, but even if it doesn't, it wouldn't make a bit of difference, O king. We still wouldn't serve your gods or worship the gold statue you set up. But even if he doesn't. Even if he doesn't do things the way I think he ought to do. Please notice, they weren't completely sure that God would perform a miracle and save them. If we're thrown in the blazing furnace, God is able. Look at your neighbor and say, God is able. There is a resolve and an understanding here that the greatness of God is not dependent on what God does or doesn't do for you. Amen. But it's because of who you are. Yes. That's why I worship him. That's why I serve him. My resolve is I trust God. I trust God with my life and my future. I trust God in this decision-making process that which he declares is right and holy and just if we follow after him, even if he doesn't do it my way. I'm still not going to serve the enemy. I'm still not going to put myself in opposition to the word of God. I'm going to live that which is right before God. But the Bible says, God is able. God is able. Romans chapter 4, verse 20 declares, Abraham never wavered in believing God's promise. I don't mean to freak you out looking for a slide up there. This is new. Abraham, it's Romans chapter 4, verse 20. Y'all can just look it up in your Bible like the old-fashioned days. Wouldn't that be fun? Abraham never wavered in believing God's promise. In fact, his faith grew stronger, and then he brought glory to God. Listen to verse 21. He was fully convinced that God is able to do whatever he promises. He was fully convinced that God is able. We face bad situations over which we have no control. We're powerless. We can't do anything about it. These three friends were being led by an armed guard to this fiery furnace. Sometimes we feel that way, like we're being led into situations we can't do anything about. We can't stop them. But it's clear from Scripture and our everyday experience that sometimes bad things happen. Amen. But we can still count on God. Amen. I said we can still count on God. Amen. And He will help us. He will help us. But my resolve today, in making a right decision, my resolve is that I'm going to do the right thing, even if. Here's what I know about sometimes the way we conduct our relationship with the Lord, is that everything is good with God when everything goes our way, and that our definition of what is good is what benefits us. Okay? But what I want you to understand today is that the goodness of God does not change based on your circumstances or some of the things you've done to get you there. God's character doesn't change, but sometimes ours does. And sometimes we've got ourselves knee-deep in a mess and wanted to know why God let that happen. Because He gave us a free will. I feel a preach coming on. Do you hear me this morning? I'm just thankful to the Lord for his goodness. And I'm so thankful that it doesn't depend on our circumstances or our mood. Amen. And the goodness of God is for us all. So here's what I know. The result of the last thing I want to show you this morning. The result of my resolve is His presence. Amen. The result of my resolve is His presence. Because when they threw them in there, Nebuchadnezzar says, he's counting and he saw three and He said, there appears to be a fourth one in the fire, and it appears like the Son of God. Just like God transformed this evil furnace into a strange yet difficult blessing for our three friends, notice that this beautiful blessing wasn't available to them before they entered the furnace, and it wasn't available after they left. But this blessing was only available to them when they were in the fire. You say, Pastor, are you crazy? Well, that's not really the issue. We'll have that discussion some other day. The strange and difficult truth is that sometimes if you want the blessing, you have to go through the fire first. The blessing only comes through the trial. The blessing only comes through the hardship. The blessing only comes through the suffering because you learn to trust in God. It is in that moment when it's hot and when it's difficult and it seems impossible and someone else is dragging you to a place that you don't want to go and that you don't want to be, that God shows up. And His presence is there. It still hurts. It's still difficult. It was then that Nebi recognized there was one who looked like the Son of God. For we are assured of His presence. Here's the good news. God loves us with a love from which neither life nor death, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation shall be able to separate us. Including a fiery furnace, or a terrorist attack, or a terminal illness, or a drunk driver, or an IED on a road in Afghanistan or Iraq, or a miscarriage, or a bankruptcy, or a business failure, or unemployment, or drug addiction, or divorce, or even a terrible motorcycle accident as a young person in our community experienced this week. The appearance of the fourth man in the fire is the blessing of my resolve, that nothing shall be able to separate us from the love of God. Let me read it to you in the Message. I am absolutely convinced that nothing living or dead, say amen, amen, angelic or demonic, amen, today or tomorrow, high or low, thinkable or unthinkable, absolutely nothing can get between us and God's love because of the way Jesus, our Master, has embraced us. Now let me read it to you in the Living Bible. For I'm convinced that nothing can ever separate us from His love. Death can't and life can't. The angels won't, and all the powers of hell itself cannot keep God's love away. Our fears for today, our worries about tomorrow, or where we are high above the sky, or in the deepest ocean, nothing will be able to separate us from the love of God demonstrated by our Lord Jesus Christ when He died for us. Nothing shall be able to separate us from the love of God. What I am struck with in this story and in our journeys is that they went through the fire. They went into the fire. They were thrown into the fire with an even if mentality. I'm going to serve God. I'm going to live for God. I'm going to go after God no matter what happens. Because here's what I know. If we only serve Jesus on the good days, who are you going to turn to on your bad days? I think I'm going to write that down. Amen? I've often said, and I hear myself say it more and more. Well, I'm 55, I repeat myself. Who are we kidding? But more and more I hear myself saying, I don't know what people do in the midst of the kind of trials that we're talking about if they don't have Jesus and a church family. I don't know how they get on the other side of that. I don't know what they do. But here's what I know. Daniel chapter 3, verse 27 in the Message says it this way. All the important people, the government leaders and king's counselors gathered around to examine them. Examinate. I'm making up words. And discovered that the fire hadn't so much as touched the three men. Not a hair singe, not a scorch mark on their clothes, not even the smell of fire on them. How do you prevent a sunburn? Stick with Jesus, folks. Not a hair singed, not a scorch mark on their clothes, not even the smell of fire. If any of you have ever been through the tragedy of a fire, you know that smell of smoke when it burns stuff. In my experience, particularly as a child, we came back from the country. One weekend, we came back early. We'd gotten a call that my mom's mom, my grandma Couch's house, her little house behind the big house, had caught on fire, and so we went there and. It wasn't a total loss, but several of the walls were burned, and so then that was the final straw. That's the day Daddy said, "Grandma, you're coming to live with us." And so we moved her stuff in, and I have memories for years that there were certain boxes or certain things of Grandma's that always had that smell, and that it never went away. And I'm struck by that this morning, because that's exactly what the enemy has planted in some of your heads, is that the effects of what he did will never go away. That fire, that difficult time, that bitterness, that hurt, it's never going to go away. That smell is always going to be there. The memory of how he got you that time is always going to be there for you. But I proclaim to you this morning on the authority of the Word of God. They couldn't even smell the fire on them. And they'd been right in the middle of it. I tell you, that's a word from heaven for somebody here this morning. For many of us, somebody's today. Is that the enemy thinks he got you. That the memory of that moment, of that heartbreak, of that moment where the enemy convinced you that the Lord let you down. Well, I want you to know that you're still here, you're still breathing, and you still have something to do for God. I said you still have something to do for God. My resolve that I'm going to do the right thing, even if ... And I have the assurance of his presence. And that nothing can separate me from the love of God. Amen. Do you believe that this morning?
Yes, amen.
Do you believe that this morning? For this story is one that involves many layers of what happens in culture. What happens when there is this mixture of God's people in a land that is not their own. You'd say, well, America, this is my America, this is my land. The Bible tells us that we are aliens. We are foreigners. We are passing through this spherical ball called earth. That our citizenship, that our home, is in heaven. So the lessons of not being sucked in to bow and worship because it's popular, the resolve that I'm going to do the right thing even if, assures me of God's presence, because I don't know anything else that's going to get us through but the presence of the fourth man in the fire.